ladies and gentlemen. Professor Jan van Biel is a Dutch mathematician who received his PhD in 1977 at the Free University in Amsterdam. He was then a visiting researcher in the USA for 2 years. From 80 to 2011, he worked as a researcher and lecturer at the Free University, and from 84 as a professor. Between 1995 and 2001, he was the head of the Geometry and Topology Department. From 2002 to 2005, he was deputy dean of the Free University Faculty of Science, and from 2006 to 2010, he was the dean. He retired from the university in 2012, and from 2014 to the present, he is a professor of topology at the University of Amsterdam. His status is indicated by the fact that he was the president of the Royal Dutch Society of Mathematicians from 2004 to 2006, and in 2012, he received the title Officer in the Order of Orange Nassau, which is the highest Dutch civilian award. He was a plenary or invited speaker at countless conferences. He has been the editor of the highly prestigious journal Topology and Its Applications since 1987, and its editor-in-chief since 2000. He is the editor of the journals Fundamenta Mathematici, Questions and Answers in General Topology, Questiones Mathematici. His versatile and prolific work is shown by the fact that he has 324 publications on MathSciNet with 2,000 references. Among them are 2 monographs and 5 other collections of articles, of which he is co-editor. His research also covers the geometric and set theory areas of topology. It's very rare to find a researcher who has achieved results of similar significance in both fields, only for the largest ones, for instance, P.S. Alexandrov or K. Kazimierz Kuratowski can be compared in this field. His geometrical researches mainly fall into the field of infinite dimensional topology, and he also wrote 2 monographs on this topic. The main subject of this area is the Hilbert cube, or investigation of the topological properties of Hilbert space-based manifolds. Another main area of his research is the examination of the different homogeneity properties of topological spaces, and he is a leading expert in this field. We emphasize his results concerning Erdős spaces, that's the title of today's talk, and topological groups. He verified, for example, that extremely pseudo-compact abelian groups can be metrized, and that the product of 2 countably compact groups can be uncountably compact. The former was an open problem for 25 years, the latter one was open for 55 years. Among his purely set theoretic topological results, the results related to the remainder of the Chehstone compactification of countably discrete spaces stand out. Significant is his new research in the field of topological semantics of modal and intuitionistic logics. We emphasize his connection with the Hungarian school of set theory and topology, marked by the names of András Hajnal and István Juhász, especially his joint results with Juhász and his group. 10 of these results have been published since 1980, and more are in preparation. This work has greatly boosted by his 3-month visit to the Rényi Institute in 2016, which was supported by the Hungarian Academy of Sciences Distinguished Guest Researcher Program. And the main reason that we are here today is that last year, in 2022, at the assembly of the Hungarian Academy of Sciences, Professor Jan van Mill was elected to be a honorary member of the Hungarian Academy of Sciences. So, Professor Jan van Mill, I kindly ask you to deliver your talk first. The floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much for this wonderful introduction. I'm really flattered by what you said about me. Not everything is true, but it's wonderful if somebody says such things. Thank you very much. Well, let me start with the next this slide. I hope you all know this man. If you don't know him, you are in deep trouble here.
Or very young.
I beg your pardon?
Or very young.
Or very young, yes. Paul Erdős, and I will talk about something, what he did in 1940, which now has a very strong impact. And I hope to convince you what it is and what the impact is 80 years later after he did it. But the story of today starts with a Dutch mathematician, Luitzen Egbertus Jan Brouwer. I hope you also know all of his name. He is the pearl of Dutch mathematics. And just before 1700, there were two Dutch-Belgian mathematical geniuses that we still know today, namely Simon Stevin and Christian Huygens. Simon Stevin was born in Belgium. There is always a very strong competition between Belgium and the Netherlands, so I must be very, very careful in a public lecture to claim him for the Netherlands. So he was born in Belgium, but he moved to the Netherlands and stayed all of his life in the Netherlands. So it's fair to say that we can skip a Belgian here, but I hope there are no Belgians in the audience. In any case, these two fellows are very known mathematical geniuses, and everybody in the audience knows them. And in the three centuries since, there is only one in Holland, namely Brouwer, Bertus Brouwer. He had a very long, a complicated name. However, all his colleagues called him Bertus. Bertus is an old-fashioned Dutch name for boys. He is so famous that there even is a post stamp made of him in Holland. This is the ultimate fame, not being a professor of mathematics at some famous university, not being elected to the Academy of Sciences. The biggest fame is if you are on a stamp in my country. And he is on a stamp, on a postage stamp. Brouwer is famous for two different things. He initiated modern topology, and he laid the foundation for intuitionistic mathematics, including all sorts of very nice, there's logic, which is now a very fundamental, for example, in theoretical computer science. He had no idea that his work would be important in theoretical computer science, but his logics are very well known and important now. If I talk to computer science friends, they say now that he is more famous for his logic than he is famous in the topology, but I, of course, disagree very strongly in that. I think he is more important for his work in topology. We all know his work, we all use his work. The Brouwer fixed point theorem is used all over the place in all sorts of mathematics, and I think he is most famous for that. In 1913, a long time ago, he presented the first formal a definition of the dimension dim x of a topological space x. Dim x is an integer. It starts with -1, but that's for the empty space. If you have no points in your space, you give it dimension -1. So then you come to zero-dimensional spaces, one-dimensional, two-dimensional, etc. And it was Brouwer, building on some earlier work of French mathematicians, who first formally defined what the dimension of a topological space is. And the dimension of a topological space is a measure for how complicated it is. If the number increases in a topological sense, your space becomes more and more complicated. It is some sort of a measure. And so, what is a topological space in this lecture? It's simply a subspace of some Euclidean space Rn. So it's a very simple object. Rn, you all know Euclidean open sets, and you know what a subspace of a topological space is. So to keep things easy, we will only deal with Rn and with subspaces of Rn, with a few exceptions, but this will come just later, and also those will not be complicated. So if X is a subset of Rn, you make it a subspace by saying what the open subsets of X are. And the open subsets of X are simply traces of Euclidean open subsets in Rn on X. That's it. So here we have our Rn, here we have Rn, here we have our subspace X, here we have our open or closed subset in Rn, and we simply intersect it with X, and that is a relatively open set in X. It is as easy as that. So nothing really complicated. So what did Brouwer prove? He proved that the topological dimension of Rn is equal n, yes, as it should be. But this is not linear, this dimension. This is not algebraic, this dimension. This is topological dimension. So if you look at Rn as a topological space, its dimension is equal to n. And this is what Brouwer proved. And from that, and that was motivating for him, and that was the real reason why he did study is, he could see that Rn is not homeomorphic to Rm if n is not equal m. And this was the real reason why he was interested in this business. He wanted to tell Rn apart from Rm if n is not equal m. And but can we say something about the dimension of other topological spaces, of other subspaces of Rn? Can we say something of interest about them? And yes, we can. So let's see a few examples. The Cantor middle search set in the unit segment, we all know that. It's a subset of the real, so it's a subspace, it's a topological space. The set of all rational numbers on the real line, it's a subset of the real line, so it's a subspace, it's a topological space. The set of all irrational numbers in the real line, it's a topological space. But there is, with these examples, something very interesting happening, and that will be important in my lecture, so I want to point it out to you. So what is interesting? So let's look at the real line R here, and let's look at all the rational points on the real line. So all these colored dots are the rational points on the real line. So here is the point zero on the real line. It is rational, so it is inside our subspace, the rational numbers. And let's look at the interval minus pi over n, pi over n. Well, pi is irrational, so minus pi over n, and pi over n is not an element of the rational numbers. And what can we see? Well, if we trace this closed interval, minus pi over n and pi over n, on Q, we do the same thing. We get the same subset if we trace the open interval minus pi over n on Q. So if we trace a closed set on the rational numbers, we see the same thing as if we trace an open set on the rational numbers. That is what we call a clopen set. It's not a very interesting notation, but a subset of a topological space, which is both a closed and open, is called a clopen set. And these clopen sets are arbitrarily small. If you make this n very big, you see a very tiny little interval about a zero in the rational numbers which is Clopen. So the rational numbers is loaded with Clopen sets and which are also very small. So let's make this a little formal now. A Q is an example of a zero-dimensional space. I said that we begin with the definition of dimension with the trivial case minus one, that is the empty set. And now we have an example of a zero-dimensional space, and that is Q. And what is the formal definition of a zero-dimensional space? I, in fact, already explained it. But so let's say formally, the neighborhood of a point is a subset which contains that point, which contains an open subset of the space containing that point. So the neighborhood of a point, that is a set, it contains the point, and in between you see an open subset, and that's called a neighborhood. So an open neighborhood is simply an open subset in your topological space which contains that point. And the space is zero-dimensional if every point has arbitrarily small Clopen neighborhoods. Arbitrarily small means in every neighborhood you will find a Clopen neighborhood. And I just proved for you that the rational numbers is an example of a zero-dimensional space because you can make all these intervals with irrational endpoints as small as you want, and you can do that at every point. So that's a zero-dimensional space. And the Cantor middle third set is zero-dimensional, space of irrational numbers. The same argument is an example of a zero-dimensional space and irrational numbers, but no Euclidean space Rn is zero-dimensional. And now it is easy to see that if X and Y are spaces, we can form what is called a topological product of the spaces X and Y. Its topology is simply generated by open rectangles. So you take an open subset in the first vector, you take an open subset in the second vector, and you multiply these and you see an open rectangle, and that all this collection of open rectangles generates this topology, and that is the product topology. And now you can prove very easily, if you take any topological space and you take any other zero-dimensional topological space, and if you multiply this topological space, X, with the zero-dimensional space, its dimension does not change. A very simple proof. So if you multiply spaces with zero-dimensional vectors, its dimension does not increase, as to be expected, because zero-dimensional spaces have lots of Clopen sets. They are rather simple, so nothing of interest happens if you multiply with a zero-dimensional space from the dimension theoretic perspective. So multiplying the space with a zero-dimensional vector does not raise this dimension. So what happens if we multiply this with a one-dimensional vector? Well, with a one-dimensional vector, it can raise dimension, because we all know that the dimension of the real line is one, as was proved by Brouwer, and the dimension of R square is two, as proved by Brouwer. So if you take the one-dimensional space R, you multiply it by the one-dimensional space R, its dimension raises. So if you multiply with a one-dimensional vector, the dimension can raise. If you multiply with a zero-dimensional vector, the dimension never raises. And this generates a very interesting problem. Namely, does a dimension always raise if we multiply with a one-dimensional a vector space? Does it always raise? I will come to to Eddowes in a moment. Don't worry, you may think, what does this have to do with Eddowes? I will come to him in a moment. He will be very prominent in my lecture. Don't worry, just hang on for a moment with me. So, does dimension always raise if we multiply with a one-dimensional factor? That's a very interesting natural problem. And this was one of the problems that kept a dimension theorists busy after the pioneering work of Brouwer. I told you that Brouwer proved that the dimension of Rn is n. From that, he concluded that the Euclidean spaces of different dimension are not homeomorphic, and that was his aim. And strangely enough, he stopped working in a dimension theory after this. And this was what he wanted, and he got it, and he stopped. And it made him world famous. And then he started digging into intuitionistic mathematics. But there were, of course, other people who continued his work. Menger, Jurisohn in Russia, all over the place. There were many people who continued his work. And at that time, this was one of the central questions. Does dimension raise if we multiply with a one-dimensional factor? And one of them was Witold Hurewicz, who lived from 1904 until 1956. He was Polish. Well, he was born in Lodz, now in Poland, but then in the Russian Empire. And he got a very good education because he was employed in Amsterdam from 1927 until 1936, first as an assistant of Brouwer, but later as a professor of mathematics. And so he learned a lot from Brouwer, and Brouwer learned a lot from Hurewicz, because Hurewicz was a very, very, very strong mathematician. So he was interested in many things, ranging from topology to algebraic topology, to set theory, and many other things. He was really a very strong guy. He was in Amsterdam working on his dimension theory, for example. All right, so here he is. After his stay in Amsterdam, he immigrated to the United States of America, and he became one of the founders of algebraic topology there. He already did algebraic topology in Amsterdam, for example. He did higher homotopy theory, and he already did it in Amsterdam and developed it even more in the United States. We all know that he died very early, at the age of 52, he fell off a pyramid in Mexico, and that ended his life, unfortunately, because he was a brilliant guy. So, what did he prove? Hurewicz had a partial answer to the problem I posed, and they were interested in. If you multiply with a one-dimensional factor, does it increase the dimension by one? And Hurewicz proved in 1935, if X is compact and Y is one-dimensional, you all know what a compact space is in Rn. It's a bounded closed subset. So think of bounded closed subsets of Rn. If you take such a set, you multiply it by a one-dimensional space, then the dimension raises with one. The dimension of X cross Y is the dimension of X plus one. And he naturally wondered, is my assumption of the compactness essential? All right? And it implies that the dimension of Rn is equal n. Well, the real line is not really compact, but it's locally compact. It's close enough to a compact space. From Hurewicz's theorem, you can conclude that the dimension of Rn is n. So it is stronger than what Brouwer did. And it uses non-trivial results from algebraic topology. And so Hurewicz wondered, is compactness essential? And yes, okay, it's there. He wondered about it, and it's a good problem. And while thinking about it, he was unable to really calculate the dimension of a certain topological space. So he had an example. It was a candidate counterexample, and he was unable to decide that it was really a counterexample to his problem. And this space is now known as Eder space, and this is the object of today's lecture. So what is Eder space? It's a very interesting, a very simple looking space. Just consider the well-known Hilbert space. Well, you said, I said we will only deal with subsets of Rn, and this is certainly not a subset of Rn, but it is a well-known topological space that you all know. You will have another problem understanding Hilbert space. So what is it? Hilbert space is the subsets of all countable sequences from the reals, so which are square summable. So you collect all x in R to the infinity such that the squares of the coordinates sum up to a finite set, to a finite element from the reals. Squares are summable. Well, it's a norm space. If you take this formula, it's an extension of the standard norm on Rn. You get a norm on L2. And so every norm gives you a metric. The distance between two points is the norm of its difference. So it's also a topological space. So you have a metric. So L2 is a Banach space, even it is a Hilbert space. It is infinite dimensional in every sense you think it can be, both in the topological and in the algebraic sense. So Eder space is the subspace of all points in the Hilbert space, all of whose coordinates are rational. And remember that I explained to you that if you look at the set of rational numbers on the real line, it's a zero-dimensional space. Now, this is something like the space of rational numbers. It's all the points in Hilbert space, all coordinates of which are rational. It looks like something like the rational numbers. And this is what Hurewicz's example was. And why was he interested in this example? He was interested, it's sometimes also referred to as the rational Hilbert space. All coordinates of all points are rational. And you also have the irrational Hilbert space. That's all points from Hilbert space, all coordinates of which are irrational. That's called irrational Hilbert space. Why was Hurewicz interested in it? Because Eder space is trivially homeomorphic to its square, because you can mix coordinates of points. You have two points, that's an infinite sequence of rational numbers. You have another point, infinite sequence of rational numbers, and you mix them, and you have again a sequence of rational numbers, and you must verify that that is again the point from Hilbert space. It is, and it is a homeomorphism. So it's trivially homeomorphic to its square. So if Eder space would be one-dimensional, it would exactly be the counterexample Hurewicz was looking at. But he could not compute its dimension. And he could prove its dimension is at most one. That is rather simple. So its dimension is either zero, like in the case of the rational numbers, or it's one, then he would have his example, but he could not decide. And the story goes like this. So if the dimension were one, he would be done. The story is Hurewicz was at Princeton. Eders came to visit. Hurewicz said, I have a nice problem for you. Oh, yes, okay. So Hurewicz, so what is Hilbert space? What's a topological space? What is dimension? Okay, just Hurewicz explained it. Eders went to his bed. And the next morning, he came with a solution. Eder's proved that the dimension of Eder space is one, and also the dimension of the complete Eder space is one. So overnight, he saw what...
You didn't say that complete Eder space is the irrational Eder space.
Yes, complete Eder space, yes. Yes, the irrational Eder space is sometimes also referred to as complete Eder space because it is a complete space, it's a topologically complete space, and therefore it's called, well, thank you, István, it's called a complete Eder space. So Eder proved that both of these spaces are one-dimensional. And he published it in 1940 in the Annals of Mathematics, now almost 80, now more than 80 years ago. And here is his paper, here is proof that he really did it. The dimension of the rational points in Hilbert space. And his proof is really, really beautiful and simple. And I want to show it to you. How did Eder prove this? So let me recall, what is a zero-dimensional space? A zero-dimensional space is a space which is loaded with sets which are both open and closed, which are Clopen sets. So, and every point has a neighborhood basis, arbitrarily small neighborhoods which are Clopen sets. That is a zero-dimensional space. So, if you want to prove that Eder space is not zero-dimensional, you must disprove that it is zero-dimensional. So, you must find a point at which that space does not have arbitrarily small Clopen neighborhoods. So you must find this point. Or equivalently, there are a point X and the neighborhood U, so that inside that neighborhood you will not find a Clopen neighborhood of that point. So this is what Eder proved for Eder space. So it is this. You must find a point. In Eder's case, he took the zero vector in Eder space. This is the point all coordinates of which are zero. You must find a neighborhood. He took an open ball, say an open ball with radius one. It doesn't matter how big the radius is. So what do you have to prove? Zero, you have your point. You have your open neighborhood. You have to prove that if there is another open set which contains the point and which lies in this chosen neighborhood, it's not closed. So you must find some point here at which that neighborhood V accumulates. And this is what you must prove. It's not closed, so you must find the point at which it accumulates. Now, here is his proof. And you will be stunned if you have not seen it before by its beauty and its simplicity. So let V be an open set such that the zero element of Hilbert space is in there, and U is an open subset of Eder space, and we take all points in Eder space of norm less than one, and we take an open subset in between. And we must produce a limit point of that set V, which is not in the set V. We must produce such a point. And we will show it's not Clopen, it's not closed. And okay, so here we go. Inductively, we choose a sequence of points. And we begin, if I equal 1, with the point with Q1 equals 0. 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. It must be in V, and the distance of the point x1 towards the complement of V must be at least 1. Okay, that is true, because 0, 0, 0 is in V, is in U, is in is in everything of norm, just less than one. So the distance from zero until its complement is exactly one. So the start of our induction works. Now assume that we know our points, the q1 until q minus, until qi minus 1. And here we look at all these coordinates as in the unit segment. And we chop up the unit segment in I plus 1 intervals of length of 1 over I. So we are in the I step, so we chop it up in I plus 1 intervals, no, in I plus 1 intervals of length 1 over I. And okay, so this is what we do. Now, if we look at the first element, then we take 0, then it's q1 until qi minus 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, and by our inductive hypothesis, this is in V. Okay? If we took at xii, then we are at q1, qi minus 1, I over I, and that's 1. So we are in a point with norm at least 1. We are outside V. So it's a finite sequence of points. You begin in V, and after finitely many steps, you know you are outside V. So there is a first place where you are in V, where the next step is outside V. So there is a first M0 such that xi M0 is in V, and the next one is not in V. And what is the distance between xi M0 and xi M0 just plus 1? Well, then you have here M0 over I, and you have M0 just plus 1 over I, and that difference is 1 over I. If you square it, and if you take its square root, you know it is a 1 over I. So you have a point in V, so that it has distance 1 over I towards a point not in V. And so the QI, the point Edders looked at, is M0 over I, and that works. And then you take this infinite sequence of rational numbers that you find out of this process, and then that X is as required. This is what he did. This is all he did. And in 1940, it gave him a paper in the Annals of Mathematics. Good for him. The proof actually shows that every non-empty Clopant set of E is unbounded in norm. Now, if there were no Clopant sets in E, it would not be interesting, but you can prove that E is totally disconnected in the sense that you can separate any two points by Clopant sets. I will not go into this. Also, the dimension of the irrational Edder space, of the complete Edder space, is one by an identical proof. And these spaces are now called Edder spaces in the literature. Okay, so for many years, Edder spaces showed up in books about this dimension theory. And this is an example. You see, it starts with the book of Hurewitz-Wolman in 1941, and it goes on until a book by Sakai in 2022. And this is an example. I cannot read Russian. There also have to be many books in Russian where the same space is mentioned. I did not collect them. It's an example. In many books, everybody where one wanted a space which is one-dimensional, whose square is one-dimensional, it was Edder space. And it was sort of as some curious space, and it was in many books. And this is just a sample. And then in 1996, the paper appeared by Kawamura Overstegen, he is a Dutchman too, and Tim Chetten, and entitled On Homogeneous Totally Disconnected One-Dimensional Spaces, published in Fundamenta. And they proved something very interesting. They were interested in fans, I will not go into this, and there suddenly, and Lelek, he's a Polish mathematician, he constructed a very interesting fan, it's called the Lelek fan, and they were interested in the topological structure of the endpoints of this Lelek fan. And they proved that set is homeomorphic topologically to the complete Eder space, to the irrational Eder space. And they proved more, that the complete Eder space is homeomorphic to the set of endpoints of the so-called universal separable R-tree and to the set of endpoints of the Julia set of the exponential map. So suddenly, the complete Eder space surfaced in other areas of mathematics. It was no longer seen as some exotic, strange counterexample in a topological dimension theory, but suddenly it surfaced in a continuum theory as well as dynamics in a natural way. This is what they proved, a great paper. And the space EC is complete. I told it earlier, it's a complete space. And it turned out to be a much simpler a topological object than the original Eder space E, which is incomplete, and you have a lots of complicated problems there that you do not see in EC. E is an absolute F sigma delta, I will not go into this. Cauchy sequences do not necessarily converge there, while in the complete Eder space, the Cauchy sequences converge. And that has created a tremendous complications, a technical complications when dealing with the Eder space. So, here is their paper. It's a great paper. They brought, they put life in the Eder spaces. And so this paper drew the attention of my colleague Jan Dijkstra and myself somewhere in the year 2000. He was my first PhD student, and he graduated in 1983. And we looked at this paper and we were interested in it. And at that time, we were interested in the topological structure of the group of all homeomorphisms of some interesting space X. So you have a topological space X, it has homeomorphisms, it is a group. On this group, you can endow it with a this topology. It's usually the compact open this topology. What is it? You look at all pairs k, u, where k is a compact subset of x and u is open in x, and you look at all homeomorphisms which move k, the compact set, in the open set, and that generates a this topology, and you call it the compact open topology. And so, you have a space, you have an abstract group of homeomorphisms, you make of it a topological space, and you ask yourself, how does this space look like? We are curious people, mathematicians. We want to know how things look like. So H of X is often a topological group, but not always. So what can we say about groups of homeomorphisms and their topological structure? Not a lot, unfortunately. We cannot say really very much. If you start with the Cantor middle search set, if you look at its full group of homeomorphisms, it's homeomorphic to the space of irrational numbers. So we are not interested in group isomorphisms, topological homeomorphisms, a classification of these objects. H of the Cantor set is a topological space. The space of irrational numbers is a topological space, and they are homeomorphic. So this homeomorphism has no relation to the algebraic properties on this group. Now, if you look at the real line, h of the real line has a component, the strictly increasing function and the strictly a decreasing function. So hc of r is the identity component of the group of homeomorphisms of the real line. It's homeomorphic to Hilbert space, so it contains the Eder space as a subspace. It's topologically homeomorphic to the Hilbert space. First proven by Dick Anderson, and then an elementary argument of it was found by Morton Brown. What happens if you look at R square? If you look at the identity component of the group of homeomorphisms of R square, it's an L2 manifold. And the proof is terrible. It's very, very, very complicated. It was proven by Luke and Mason. Now you think a good success. What happens with R3? A very natural problem. You look at the group of homeomorphisms of R3, you look at its identity component. What is it? Nobody knows. A problem which is open maybe for 50 years already. Nobody knows. On the other hand, if you go to the other extreme, the Hilbert cube, so you neglect all the finite dimensions and you go up to the Hilbert cube, you know it's homeomorphic to L2. It was proven independently by Ferry and Storunczyk. And then Kiesling proved that if you have a solenoid, it's a solenoid of Van Danzig. He is another Dutchman. I like always to mention Dutch mathematicians. H of a solenoid is homeomorphic to a solenoid across L2, across a certain set. This is a discrete set, either 2 points or otherwise countably many points. Why this notation? Because this as a group is isomorphic to the group of isomorphism of topological isomorphisms of this solenoid. This is basically all what is known in the literature on the topological structure of all groups of homeomorphisms on interesting spaces. I don't know of any other result that I could mention here. Now, at the time that we were slowly starting to think of this, we accountable dense homogeneity, East van Til knows it, at conferences, and we would hear many, many lectures about countable dense homogeneity. It was prominent. A countable dense homogeneity means that in a topological space, all countable dense subsets are topologically equivalent. So if you give me two countable dense sets, I must give you a homeomorphism which moves one countable set onto the other. That is countable dense homogeneity. It's a classical notion. Brouwer proved in 1913 that Rn has this property, and Fréchet did it a few years earlier and independently. So at that time, we were also interested in countable dense homogeneity. So Dijkstra and myself thought, well, maybe we can solve a simpler problem. Let's look at the group of all homeomorphisms of an interesting topological space which fix set-wise some given countable dense set D. So look at all the homeomorphisms in your group such that HD is D for some interesting space X, such as Rn and an arbitrary countable dense set. From the result of Brouwer, we know it doesn't matter which countable dense set we choose. And we give, of course, H of XD the subspace, this topology, which it gets from H of X. Then we have another object, here's another topological space, and a rather simple idea was, well, H of D is D means somehow this homeomorphism is not so wild. So it must fix a countable dense set, so it's not so wild. And so maybe we can think something there. So let's start at the beginning. At the first space you think then is the real line, okay? So you look at the real line, and you take a countable dense set, can you identify a topological type of the group of homeomorphisms which fix the countable dense set D? And we proved in 2006 it's homeomorphic to the countable product of the rational numbers. It's Q to the infinity, the countable infinite product of copies of the rational numbers. And so it is a zero-dimensional space. Okay, success. We know it for the reals. What happens if we look at R square? How about the group of homeomorphisms of R square where we fix a countable dense set? And remember that we know how the identity component of the group of all homeomorphisms of R square looks like, because I told you it's an L2 manifold. So at least it is a good space, it is a nice space, and so how does it look like? Well, after some thinking, we could prove it's not a zero-dimensional. And already that is quite complicated. It took us a while to figure out that subgroup of H of R square is not a zero-dimensional. Okay, so what is it? So we investigated a bold conjecture. It's homeomorphic to Eder space. Why Eder space? We could not think of anything else. It's the only thing we could think about. Of course, we were thinking about it. We saw some Clopen sets, and we thought, what else can it be than Eder space? We had no other idea to what it could be. So we tried to prove it. So how do you prove something like that? You have two very different objects. You have Eder space, it's the rational Hilbert space. It sits in Hilbert space. It sits there in a certain way. And you have R2, you have a countable dense set, you have a homeomorphism, the group. Okay, it's a topological space also, and that's basically all you know. So you have two very, 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 very distinct objects. And you want to prove that they are a topologically homeomorphic, so you must produce a homeomorphism between these two very distinct objects. And there is only one way you can do that. You must look at Eder space, stare at it, and find a good, usable topological characterization of it, and then apply your topological characterization to the space you are interested in. There's only one way you can do that. So we were for the task, how can we get a topological characterization of Eder space? Topological characterization means the only thing you can use is topological notions. They may be complicated, topological notions, but you must express them in a topological language. That's the only thing you are allowed to use for such a characterization. And similar to well-known characterizations of spaces, for example, the Cantor middle search set, I talked about it earlier, is the unique compact zero-dimensional space without isolated points, proven by de Brouwer. If you see a Cantor set, you look at it and you ask to yourself, is it compact? Great. Is it zero-dimensional? Great. Does it have no isolated points? Even greater, because then you know topologically you have the Cantor set. And that's a very simple characterization. Much more complicated. Turunchik in 1978 proved that the Hilbert cube is topologically the unique, a compact absolute retract which has the disjoint cells property. It is an absolute retract, and you must be able to pull everything apart what you can pull apart. Then you have the Hilbert cube. Again, purely a topological statement, and if your space satisfies those statements, it is the Hilbert cube, topologically. Many, many other known spaces in this topology have such characterizations, the real line, the interval, the circle, Hilbert cube, L2, two-dimensional manifolds, compact groups, solenoids, etc., etc., etc. So this is what we had to do. And in 2010, we proved increasingly powerful topological characterizations of Adler space. And it was published in the as a memoir in the American Mathematical Society. It was 70 pages, so we could not publish it in a regular journal, but they were happy to take it. And we went from external to internal. So we first stared at Adler space in an ambient space and characterized how Adler space sits in this ambient space. And after we had that, we were digging deeper and found the conditions that ensured that a given space has these properties. And so we had an internal characterization of Adler space. And here is the characterization. I'm not going to tell you what it is, only that it is in purely topological terms. Adler space is topologically the unique topological space E having the following this property. It is an F sigma delta space. Okay. It is a witness to the almost zero dimensionality of E. Okay, okay. This is topology. You don't see any funny things there. It doesn't matter what it is. It's a purely a topological statement. There is a tree, and there are countable, and there are subspaces. And okay, if you move up these trees, and you refine your subspaces, and each element x in E has a neighborhood U, and that is an anchor for the a path in this tree. Anchor is something that controls the Cauchy sequences. I told you that in the complete Adler space, you have automatically a control over the Cauchy sequences. Here you do not have that, and that tells you that somehow you can control a Cauchy sequences. The Noether denseness, it's a topological notion. Cohesiveness is a topological notion. Noether dense sets is a topological notion. You only see a topological statements there. And if your space satisfies all these properties, it is Adler space. Now, of course, no journal would ever publish such a theorem if you would not have interesting applications for it. I mean, if you would stop here and say, okay, and this is Adler space and the whole world must be happy with it, no journal would accept it. You must have interesting applications for the theorem like that. And we have these applications. For every n larger than or equal to 2 and for every countable dense subset d of Rn, so not only for the square, for the plane, HRn of D is homeomorphic to Adler space. So if you dig in this homeomorphism group enough, you see this structure and you can conclude it's homeomorphic to Adler space. And this was our main motivation for doing all this work. And much more. I will not go into that. We also characterized the complete Adler space, is the irrational Adler space, in a paper that appeared in 2009. It appeared earlier, but it was done later. But this is a much more complicated result than the complete Adler space, because and so it was easier for the referee to check all the results. So it appeared earlier, but it was done later. And we discussed many representations of the complete Adler space. We showed it was the endpoint sets of Julius sets of certain exponential maps. And remember that I said that Overstegen, Kawamura, and Tim Chatten did this, but we did it in a much broader setting. And that's part of dynamics. Endpoints of R-trees, that's continuum theory. Line-free groups in Banach spaces. There were certain false statements in the literature about line-free groups in Banach spaces, and we disproved these statements by showing that actually what they were dealing with is this complete adder space, and they made a mistake. So it also surfaced in Banach space theory. And polishable ideals on omega, it is descriptive set theory. So the complete adder space suddenly is all over the place, which is great. And adder space even has its own Wikipedia page now. I did not do this. Somebody else did this. And yes, Wikipedia asks you all for €2 because Wikipedia needs money. Wikipedia adder space has its own Wikipedia page now, which I think is great. And here are a few papers of the last 2 years about adder spaces. And you see all nice journals and nice authors. It's spread over the world. And here are a few more, and there's one of mine, and here are a few more, etc. Many papers. There are intriguing open problems. I run out of time, right? I run out of time, so I will go a little fast now. I will be done in 5 minutes. About the universal n-dimensional Menger continuum. That's my favorite problem. And while I was working on this lecture, it came back to me again. I looked at my notes and I see some progress now on this problem. These are very famous spaces. They were topologically characterized by the Bestfina in 1988. Overstegen and Tim Chetin conjectured in 1994 that H of mu 1, the one-dimensional Menger continuum, is homeomorphic to a complete adder space. It's not true, it was disproved in 2004. And what is it? And we believe it's homeomorphic to the countable infinite product of complete adder spaces. And just as I said, working on this problem, I think I see a handle on this problem now because of this lecture. If I solve it, I will be ever grateful to the Hungarian mathematicians for putting me back to this problem, because it's a great problem. We know that the complete adder space is not homeomorphic to its countable infinite product, so it's really a different object. And we know that the standard adder space is homeomorphic to its countable infinite product. And we know no other proof of this than via the characterization theorem. There is no direct mixing coordinates business. We need the full characterization theorem to prove this. And so, Paul Edders, when he wrote his paper in 1940, he could not have dreamed that this wonderful, beautiful combinatorial argument that he gave for the one-dimensionality of adder space would give so much rumor in the mathematical world 80 years later. I met him at the 18th Winter School on Abstract Analysis in Chrny, in the Czech Republic, in 1990. So I'm very happy that I met him. And I was one of his many admirers then at that winter school. And I'm very grateful and proud that through the adder spaces, I'm a part of his legacy. And I'm very grateful to the Hungarian Academy of Sciences for electing me. And I'm very grateful to my colleagues, István Juhász, Lajos Szukop, and Zoltán Szent Miklósi, for their fruitful and inspiring collaboration for so many years, and for their friendship. And that concludes my lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this wonderful lecture, for this very interesting introduction to the world and theory of adder spaces. I have only one more duty. First of all, I have to try to open this container. And with some care, I would like to pull out the document which is contained in here. It's not so trivial, let me tell you, but I'm managing. OK. So this is the document which will prove for your colleagues, for your friends, that you really was elected to be a honorary member of the Hungarian Academy of Sciences.
Super.
So let me congratulate you again.
Oh, thank you very much.
Let us show the document for the audience.